how we serve you, not only here, but through Wyatt, through Youth Unlimited, to reach the youth in this province. Thank you for the time he's put into this. I pray that your words be his words, and that we got our ears are open here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, everybody.
Sorry.
Good morning.
Good to be here. It's great to sing Christmas carols. I love Christmas. It is definitely one of my favorite times of the year. It is the most wonderful time of the year, as the song goes. And to be honest, I have to say that I usually start Christmas carols somewhere around mid-October. I've been known to sing Christmas carols in the summer on the hot days and things like that because I love Christmas. I love Christmas carols. In fact, some don't believe all the rumors, but some may even accuse me of using our paging system at Terra Nova to ensure that everybody enjoys Christmas carols at the same time as I do. But today is the first Sunday of December. It's the first Sunday of Advent, which means that we can definitely start celebrating Christmas. Even the biggest Scrooges in the crowd will have to say, okay, we're December, we gotta kick into gear now. So including today, there are 22 days until Christmas. So it is time to start preparing. Question is, what does preparing mean? Today when someone says that they're preparing for Christmas, we usually associate it with decorating, shopping, wrapping, baking, planning a family gathering, or even ordering an eggnog latte at Starbucks. There's nothing wrong with any of those. And in fact, I would generally encourage a lot of those things. However, if that's the extent and the depth of our celebration, we are drastically missing the point. It's spending time at Fairview is what we associate with preparing for Christmas, and I think it's time to relook at what we're preparing for. And so this morning, we're going to start this Advent season in Matthew 3 with the message of John the Baptist as he prepared for the coming Messiah. So let's read Matthew 3. In those days, John the Baptist came to the Judean wilderness and began preaching. His message was, "Repent of your sins and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near." The prophet Isaiah was speaking about John when he said, "He is a voice shouting in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord's coming. Clear the road for him." John's clothes were woven from coarse camel hair, and he wore a leather belt around his waist. For food, he ate locusts and wild honey. People from Jerusalem and from all of Judea and all over the Jordan Valley went out to see and hear John. And when they confessed their sins, he baptized them in the Jordan River. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming to watch him baptize, he denounced them. "You brood of snakes," he exclaimed. "Who warned you to flee the coming wrath? Prove by the way you live that you have repented of your sins and turned to God. Don't just say to each other, 'We're safe, for we are descendants of Abraham.' That means nothing, for I tell you, God can create children of Abraham from these very stones. Even now, the axe of God's judgment is poised, ready to sever the roots of the trees. Yes, every tree that does not produce good fruit will be chopped down and thrown into the fire. I baptize with water those who repent of their sins and turn to God. But someone is coming soon who is greater than I am, so much greater that I am not worthy even to be his slave and carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. He is ready to separate the chaff from the wheat with his wooden fork. Then he will clean up the threshing area, gather the wheat into his barn, but burning the chaff with never-ending fire." Let's pray. Father, as we just look at this passage this morning and we think of John and his role in preparing the way for the coming Messiah, I pray that you will prepare our hearts for your coming as well. And Father, as we share this morning, may I not get in the way, but may the words that I say just speak to the hearts of all of us at this time. In Jesus' name, amen. So before John arrives on the scene, there's been 400 years since the last prophets of Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. Those were kind of around the end of the Babylonian exile. And other than we do hear of Anna the prophetess when Jesus is brought to the temple, but other than her, there's no indication of any other prophets over these 400 years that are often generally called the silent years. And so if we look at the last words, or near the end of in Malachi 3, it says, "Look, I am sending my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. Then the Lord you are seeking will suddenly come to his temple, the messenger of the covenant whom you look for so eagerly is surely coming, says the Lord of heaven's armies." The people were weary of the oppression. There have been the Babylonians, there have been the Persians, there have been the Greeks, and now they're under the Roman oppression. And at this time, the people were actively waiting and looking for the coming Messiah. And John was the one that was prophesied who had prepared the way for the Lord. And at this point in history, after this long silent period, the prophetic word was again being heard. John the Baptist, John the Baptizer. And I think sometimes his name may sidetrack us from his message. Yes, he baptized. And we identify him in that way as John the Baptist, John the Baptizer, because he baptized people. But the main thrust of his ministry was not baptism. His mission, his purpose, was to prepare the way of the Lord. Baptism was simply a response to his message. John is the prophetic fulfillment of Isaiah, the passage that we read in Matthew 3, where Matthew goes back to Isaiah and the prophecy of Isaiah. In Isaiah's time, the people were living in exile. The message was a call out of exile, out of the wilderness, out of the desert. Let's read that passage that Matthew refers to, Matthew 40. "Listen, it's the voice of someone shouting, 'Clear the way through the wilderness for the Lord. Make a straight highway through the wasteland for our God. Fill in the valleys and level the mountains and hills. Straighten the curves and smooth out the rough places. Then the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together.'" The reference to Isaiah uses the figure of preparing for coming out of exile, to prepare for the arrival of a king. Now, when a royal visit was expected, no expense was spared. Roads would be prepared, mountains would literally be knocked down, valleys would be filled in order to make a smooth road for the coming king. The road through the open, uneven territory would be smoothed. Even the seemingly immovable was removed and knocked down so that the king could arrive on a straight, clear, and smooth road. And so John is a road builder for the coming king. There is one greater than he that would follow him with a full revelation. And I think we live in a similar time today. I think we can refer to or relate to that time of a wilderness, a desert, people living in darkness, longing for purpose and direction. And we have an opportunity to be road builders, to clear the way through the wilderness to Jesus, to straighten curves and smooth out rough places so that people can see God's glory and experience the freedom found in Jesus. And this time of Christmas is a natural opportunity to do that as people engage in the Christmas season. Let's look briefly at how John prepared the way, and how we in turn can prepare for the coming Jesus this Christmas season. I'm going to suggest three ways. Three ways that we can prepare for the way. Sorry, I think I mistyped that. But three ways that we can prepare for the coming King. First, prepare the way with a posture of simplicity and humility. John's posture, his demeanor, his life was one of simplicity and humility. The way he dressed and what he ate were evidence of simplicity that's lost in our culture. December, Christmas season, is a great time of year. It's a wonderful time of the year. However, it can also be one of the most stressful times of the year. One of the most lonely. One of the saddest for many. John demonstrates his simplicity in one of the ways he demonstrates is through his clothing and his food. His clothing was camel hair and a leather belt. Not the typical items you might find at Forever 21 or Garage. And though the leather belt, you might say, well, yes, we wear leather belts, but I don't believe it's the latest one that's available at Banana Republic or anywhere else at Fairview. His clothing was very simple. He did not need to draw people to himself by the way he dressed, by the way he looked, in order to have people attracted to him. His food was locusts and wild honey. Now, wild honey, okay, I can understand. I don't know that what that means exactly, what that tasted like, if how much different from the honey we have necessarily, but I can relate. Locusts, but recognize that locusts in the Old Testament were considered a clean food. And they're still eaten today in the East. In fact, I had the wonderful privilege of tasting one when I was in Thailand a few years ago. We may say it's gross, but quite frankly, I find mussels and clams and calamari to be gross too. I'm just saying. Apparently, locusts taste something between chicken schnitzel, toasted sunflower seeds, and prawns, so they say. I just swallowed mine quickly, and I don't really know that I took the time to allow my taste buds to enjoy the flavor. It was simple. He had a simple lifestyle. But he wasn't a roving lunatic in the desert. He wasn't someone walking around. Sometimes I feel people think he's wandering around yelling in the desert, almost half naked, starving. That's not who John was. He lived a simple life, but he was not a lunatic. Everyone was going out to see him. Jerusalem was a major city of the time. The New York, the Tokyo, the London, the Paris. That was Jerusalem. People were flooding out of the city to see him. Taking the metro, taking the buses, walking out to hear him, to hear his message. I think one of the reasons that people were so drawn to him was because of that simplicity and that humility that he had. This kind of posture breaks down barriers between people. He was available. He was present. He listened to the pain of their hearts, to their sins, to the burden that they were carrying in their life. And he challenged them, and he offered them hope and good news. This kind of posture draws people out and gives us the opportunity, gives us the right to speak life into people's lives. John was humble, and people were attracted to it. According to Jesus, John was the greatest prophet. He was successful and could have been proud of his accomplishments. But he knew that it was not about him. This is a very different posture than we see far too often in our day. Christians, evangelicals, are too often seen as angry, viewed as passé, or out of touch with the issues of our day. Sometimes, maybe often, that's not deserved. But often it is. Sometimes we often use our faith to justify our actions. I couldn't believe when I was listening to the news this past week or the week before, when an Alabama state auditor defended Roy more against sexual allegations, invoking Joseph and Mary, saying that Mary was a teenager and Joseph was an adult carpenter. They became the parents of Jesus. And somehow that justified the sexual allegations of an adult with a minor. This is what the world sees. And it drives me crazy. It's not the posture we want to have as we engage with the world around us. We need to move from arrogance to humility. If we want to gain the right to speak into the lives of those around us. John prepared his way through simplicity and humility, and he called others to do likewise. It's in simplicity that greatness is measured, not by what you have, but by your faith in God. Materialism is rampant today, and Christians are not spared from it. We are easily sucked into the same desires as the world around us. Yet there's an anti-materialistic component to pursuing God. We know the parable of the sower that Jesus uses. And for the one where the seed falls in thorns, the seed that fell among thorns stands for those who hear. But as they go on their way, they are choked by life's worries, riches, and pleasures. And they do not mature. Every time I read that, I struggle and I look at myself and I say, have I received this? Am I being choked by life's worries, by riches, and by pleasure? Is that keeping me from growing in maturity? We need to have our eyes on things above and not on things of this world. It doesn't mean that we can't enjoy the blessings that God has provided us. However, it is so easy to allow those things to move from blessing to central, to our focus and to our heart's desire. So this Christmas, let's prepare the way to Jesus through a posture of simplicity and humility. Are there areas in our lives that we need to simplify? Are there ways that we could posture ourselves that demonstrate far greater grace, generosity, contentment, and humility? Are we available to listen to the pain of those around us? Are we too busy with our own things and miss the opportunities that God brings our way? Second way to prepare is prepare with a message of good news. John's message is one of good news. The kingdom has come near. Luke 3 verse 18, John exhorted the people and preached the good news. John's message of good news is received through repentance. Verse 2 in Matthew 3 says, repent of your sins and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Repentance is key to understanding and receiving the good news. John brought people to an awareness of sin and their need for a Savior by preparing them for the Messiah who is coming soon. Repent indicates a conversion, a turnaround, a change in direction. It implies that a change is needed. The status quo, or doing as you please, is not in line with the coming kingdom. Now, that's not a popular concept today. Repentance isn't very popular. It implies that there is sin. And sin is viewed as intolerant and an oppressive word to I don't need to repent. I'm a good person. How dare you judge me? However, through that posture of simplicity and humility, God can open people's hearts to the message of repentance. So why did John call them to repentance? Because the kingdom of heaven is near. Repentance opens the door to the kingdom. Repentance enables us to live the life that God created us to live. A life of freedom and purpose. I know when when they were younger, though I think the same would apply to all of us at all times. But when someone had done something wrong, there was a burden that was carried, and it affected relationships, it affected the tone in the house. But when that was corrected, there was a weight that was visibly removed. And maybe sitting here, there's no one that I can that affected more than, I don't want to say that affected more than me, but that it became so clear as that weight was removed, that life had been, freedom had been restored, relationships had been restored, and was able to live a life of freedom that came through that repentance. It was a huge weight off. It's a huge weight off all of our shoulders. I don't want to associate that just with kids. We sometimes see it very clearly. Maybe as adults, we're good at hiding it more. But it is nonetheless true to us today. Repentance is not popular, but it is for a reason. For the kingdom of heaven is at hand, and that is good news. And that's the same message that Jesus preached. Jesus began to preach, repent of your sins and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near. The exact same message as John. Whenever John is mentioned, it is always to throw light on the mission of Jesus, to point to Jesus. John's message was completely aligned with the message of Jesus. He simply focused on making the path straight to him. Kind of like driving through the Ville-Marie Tunnel. You know, you go into the Ville-Marie Tunnel, and you curve back and forth, and it's just dark ahead of you. You can't see the end. And then all of a sudden, you come around that last curve, and there's light at the end of the tunnel, and you see the direction that you're going. And the John's way of preparing was to make those paths straight, to take the curves out of the ways in order to see the light at the end of the tunnel, to be able to clearly see. John straightens the path through repentance and points to the light that is at the end. Those responding to John's message were compelled to turn their lives around in generosity and grace. We see in Luke 3, a little bit, the message expanded a little bit more. The crowds asked, "What should we do?" John replied, "If you have two shirts, give one to the poor. If you have food, share it with those who are hungry." Even corrupt tax collectors came to be baptized and asked, "Teacher, what should we do?" He replied, "Collect no more taxes than the government requires." "What should we do?" asked some soldiers. John replied, "Don't extort money or make false accusations, and be content with your pay." The crowd comes, and what does John say? "Share what you have with those who need it." The tax collectors, he tells them, don't steal anymore. People hated the tax collectors. They were generally corrupt and greedy. But John said that God would accept even these men that were so hated. God would pour out mercy on those who confessed their sins and then give them strength to live the changed lives. Or the soldiers, wherever your job is, do it well. Do with fairness and be content with your earnings. Maybe a message in there for all of us. To share, to not be greedy, and to be content with what we have. Prepare for Christmas this year by communicating the good news of Jesus that is received through repentance. The message of repentance isn't always well received. But we need to communicate it in light of the good news that it is associated with, not solely as a judgment of others. If we are simply condemning others and requiring them to repent without communicating the good news, that repentance leads to we are failing in our message. And it starts with us. What are the areas of life that God is calling us to turn from, to change, to repent of? Does our message reflect the grace Jesus offered to those around him, the grace we have received? Does our message lead straight to Jesus? Or do we complicate it, cause the path to be crooked? May we clearly proclaim the good news of Jesus this Christmas. And then the third way we can prepare the way with a heart of worship. The message throughout the Old Testament is God's desire for our hearts. Hosea 6:6 says, "For I desire mercy, not sacrifice, an acknowledgement of God rather than burnt offerings." It's not about the religious traditions, but about our hearts. God wants our hearts. Hosea 29, "And so the Lord says, these people say they are mine. They honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me, and their worship of me is nothing but man-made rules learned by rote." That is likely a good description of the Pharisees and Sadducees that arrived to check on John. John gets angry because they put all their stock and importance in their careful following of the traditions and their lineage. But John says that following our religious traditions is insufficient. Being a descendant of Abraham is irrelevant. That is not the worship that God seeks. John demonstrates a true heart of worship when he begins to speak of Jesus. "But someone is coming soon who is greater than I am, so much greater that I am not worthy even to be his slave and carry his sandals." John draws this reference of untying the sandals from the practice of getting the lowest slave of a household to remove the sandals and wash the feet of guests. John's witness, therefore, reflects the exalted nature of Jesus. He placed himself below the lowest slave, recognizing who he was in light of Jesus. If we do not develop a true heart of worship, our witness will be meaningless. We need more Jesus, not more stuff. We need Jesus to come in to every one of our situations and relationships. We need a Jesus that transforms lives, that changes the story of people's lives one at a time. We need to recognize it is not our efforts, it's not my efforts that will draw anyone to Jesus. I simply have the privilege of pointing the way to him. Too often I find myself wanting to be in the road. When I do, I simply cause more curves and get in the way. I read the stories of Jesus, I read the Gospels, and I see the miracles, and I think sometimes maybe I want to be Jesus. I want to be the one that performs a sign or a miracle that helps someone come to faith. Rather, I need to be John, who is simply standing out of the way, trying to make those roads straight, to straighten the path, to make the path straight to Jesus. To not be an obstacle anywhere along the way. Too often I find myself wanting to be in the road. John says, "He must increase, but I must decrease." Our job is to be pointers, to be preparers. It's not about us. We need to be pointing people to Jesus, not trying to be Jesus. Sometimes feel like we want to be Jesus. It's interesting that John, who is the greatest prophet, the greatest pointer in history, greatest pointer to Jesus, never performed a miraculous sign. John was not the source of the light. He came only to reflect it. And we are called to reflect that same light. And so I wonder, has our practice of the faith become a routine? Has it lost its meaning? Have we lost Jesus? Why do we faithfully attend church? Do we prepare our hearts as we come to be open to what God would say to us? Do we come with anticipation of what God is going to say? Or do we come as part of our Sunday routine, ready to mentally check out at the first thing that we don't like? John spoke clearly and forcefully to those who saw their faith as little more than a set of rituals and traditions. He condemned them. My prayer is that that may not be true of us. This Christmas, let's prepare with a heart of worship, ready to meet with Emmanuel, God with us. him to use us to prepare the road for others. So what does that mean for us this Christmas? The world needs more Jesus and less Al. Needs less us, means more Jesus. Today, the fastest growing religious category in our country is nuns. I don't mean N-U-N nuns, but as in N-O-N-E nuns. People who declare that they have no religious affiliation. That does not mean that they're all atheists or agnostic. Many have a belief in God. Many have all kinds of belief. But they don't associate with any religious, they have no religious affiliation. We can prepare people to receive Christ's message through a posture of simplicity and humility. A message of good news through repentance and true worship where Jesus is truly at the center of our celebration. These verses in Luke 3, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill will be made low, and the crooked shall become straight, and the rough places shall become level ways, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. So I just encourage you to think of your neighbors, your colleagues, your friends, your family. What can you do this Christmas to clear the way through the wilderness? Are we clearing misconceptions that might be hindering them from coming to Christ? Are we blasting out the mountains through the wasteland? What obstacles can we help to remove? Are we straightening the curves? How can we make the path to Jesus straighter for those around us? How do we take those things away, the obstacles, the curves, the hindrances? Are we standing in the way? Let's smooth out these rough places. Let's be available to listen to people, to listen to their pain. Are we willing to walk with them through the rough places? Are we willing to be present in their lives? It's a natural opportunity for us at Christmas to prepare the way to Jesus, to point people to Jesus, the light of the world. John knew he had a specific and important role to play in the world, to prepare the hearts of people to receive Christ's message. And he put all his energy and effort into it. My prayer is that we would do likewise this Christmas season, so that all will see the salvation of God. Father, I thank you for the. I thank you for John. I thank you for his testimony. I thank you for his life. I thank you for his example. And Father, I thank you for his willingness to always get out of the way in order for people to be led to Jesus. And Father, I pray that this Christmas we might do the same. That we might get out of the way of people getting to Jesus. But Father, you can use us to help prepare the way, to remove the obstacles and the hindrances, to smooth the path, in order for people to clearly see the Jesus, to see you, to know you, to come to a full understanding of the good news that they can have, the good news that is received through repentance. And so, Father, I just pray that you will give us each opportunities, that we will seize the opportunities, that we will create opportunities to speak the life-giving message of Jesus, the good news of Jesus, to our colleagues, to our neighbors, to our family.